Et là, donc, je voudrais donner la parole à Madame Bonnie Nixon, qui est donc la directrice exécutive du Sustainability Consortium aux États-Unis, qui vient nous parler de leurs efforts dans le ralliement du développement durable à la stratégie d'entreprise par la science et l'action. Voilà. Bonnie Nixon.
Merci beaucoup. Good morning. So, what is the vision of the Sustainability Consortium? I think what's most important is to recognize that we are about advancing the science and sharing as much of the science as we can. I like to think of our role as we're not doing a huge amount of primary research ourselves. We're really aggregating a lot of the research that's been done. We're synthesizing it, and then we're translating it for different stakeholder groups, and finally communicating it out. So that might be communications to buyers, and let me make sure that everyone understands that the early history of the Sustainability Consortium was business driven. It was Walmart saying to many of its suppliers, we are going to start analyzing products and comparing them to one another from a life cycle approach. And much the same as what the French government has done here in just saying that we at the United States government, I mean, do not have an environment right now where it's conducive to that. So for the businesses to come forward and say, we're going to make this happen, it was fairly instrumental, and it certainly made a lot of the major brands and a lot of suppliers stand up and take notice if their customers were going to be paying attention to this. So that's really how it got started, but let me assure you that today it's not an initiative based in the United States and only in the United States, and it's not run by Walmart anymore. So I'll show you some of the members and also share with you how global we truly are. But what's important about our vision is that we're about driving innovation. It's not, we aren't really here to help companies or entities navigate international compliance. We are looking for companies who are interested in leadership. There have been some occasions, particularly since I've come on board, which is only about 6 months now, where we've asked companies to consider leaving. And the reason being that we can feel, you know, they're in this to maybe obstruct process from going forward or keep things status quo. And that's not really something we're interested in. We've got a lot to do in a short amount of time. So we're about driving innovation. We're about mainstreaming this process and operationalizing it. As I mentioned, I did only come to the consortium about 6 months ago. Prior to that, I spent 13 years at Hewlett-Packard leading the environmental sustainability and the ethical sourcing program. So I very much came to the consortium with a business background and a business slant, which honestly has been a challenge as well, because it's mostly been universities that have come together, and I'll share the universities that are participating. The mission is about credibility. If the businesses wanted to do this completely on their own, they could have, and they didn't, and they said we need civil society and academia to be leading this effort. And so the board members, the majority of the board members are civil society, are NGOs and academia. We have academic advisory council and an NGO advisory council. We also have other means for the NGOs, or ONGs, I think is what you call them, to participate. World Wildlife Fund and CARE are presently on our board. We have another incubator, and then we have them participating at the work group level. So it's about credibility. It's about transparency, providing access. I like to call it open access, not necessarily open source. For various parties, there'll be access fees, but for the most part, it's about only pursuing research that's transparent, looking at systems like EcoInvent or SEMA Pro and using Erster and OpenLCA, and ones that are really letting us see all of the research down to the primary. And then finally, it's about scalability. These are the companies that are participating. As you can see, I've put in green some of the companies that are based here in Europe. Today, about 30% of the 75 companies that are in the consortium are based here in Europe. We also have quite a bit of activity happening in Japan, and most recently, it looks like we're opening our Latin America office with a base in Mexico, Chile, and probably Brazil. And then we've had quite a bit of interest from Taiwan, Korea, of course Japan, where there's a lot of activity, Australia, and then China. So, but I think Europe has been where my focus has been over the last 6 months. I've been here about 5 times and spent at least 2 weeks here each time only in the last 6 months. These are the universities currently today that have existing contracts and partnerships with us. Wageningen is our newest complete partner. Manchester has been working with Tesco for quite some time. Tesco has, I didn't put them up as they've just recently joined the consortium, so we're excited to invite them. And while we've been here in France, we're having a meeting on Friday with Carrefour. We're meeting with Auchan. Yesterday we met with Picon, the Association of Retailers. The retail sector is very important to us, and I'll share why in a moment. But we've also met with Berlin Technical University and Denmark Technical University and Aalborg and ETH and many universities as well, and research institutes in Switzerland. And while we're here in France, we're looking for liaisons and relationships with French universities that have done LCAs. So we're quite excited about all of these relationships, and we'll draw on many of the research projects and the academics who are active in the LCA community. These are the working groups today that we're currently engaged in. And that means that we have LCA data on many of these sectors, and what we've done to date is we've produced 50 what we call level one LCAs, and I'll talk about that in a moment, and we're on our way to producing 100 of those by the end of the year. We've also done 7 very deep LCAs. Those are level two, full on to the through the PCR development stage, and so that is those are in orange juice, strawberry yogurt, wheat cereal, laptops, spray cleaners, surface cleaners, showering products, and laundry detergent. And you can see a lot of this information or get access to it on our website. We also have science groups, measurement science, consumer science, and of course we'll need a large IT platform to house all of this. And the one group that's not listed there, but we're very actively looking to start that up again, is our assurance group. You know, what type of certification or monitoring is going to be needed. We are next Tuesday having our grand opening in Wageningen. I'm in The Hague, and we are expecting, right now we have more than 200 people that are registered. We'll probably be expecting as much as 300 or 400 people from around Europe. What are we doing? So that's a lot about who we are. What we're doing is we believe we're doing something that's never actually been done before to this scale and complexity and diversity. We are committed to scientific rigor and transparency, and we're also committed to making sure that many stakeholders are involved. I should caveat that with, we're not totally committed to consensus across the board. We're committed to what I would describe as informed consent. And by that, I mean we might in many cases be at 80-20 and just move forward. We might be at 60-40 and move forward, because that's where the science is today. And that's what state-of-the-art tools are telling us today. And we know that this field is dynamic, and we know it will continue to change. But in some cases, we also recognize that the LCA community has been very active here, especially in Europe, for more than 20 years, and still discussing things like attribution versus consequential, or how we do macro analysis or temporal analysis over time, and many challenges that we're faced with biodiversity and social and toxicity. And we simply have to try and come to some resolution with one another, work together closely, see what's the best, and move forward, and hope that as more information comes out and more consensus is gained around tools, that we'll use those. So we're being very efficient by building on what already exists. We're quite familiar with, we're working with the CTAC, UNEP CTAC, we're working with the European Commission, the EU. We're familiar with initiatives like the ones happening here in France with ADEME. And we're very excited about collaborating and not reinventing any wheels. We just simply don't have time for that. We do represent a lot of the largest corporations in the world, and we're working mostly with universities who are interested in applied science. How do we make this real? How do we put it on the ground? How are we practical today? We're looking to harmonize a lot of the standards that are out there and create some very practical tools for the buying community in particular. And it's one of our goals that innovators can come online and do an LCA. I mean, I don't know the exact numbers, but maybe do one in 4 hours for $1,000 or $2,000 and not have to go a year for 60,000 euros or dollars or 3 years. We've seen many of the LCAs going 2-3 years and costing millions of dollars. And this is not the way we're going to accept or embrace innovation in this space. We're specifying very common rules and metrics. So an example of that is we all understand what a calorie is. We know what it means to put 100 calories in our body. We know what it means to put 1,000 calories in our body. But we struggle around things like carbon and water and materials and waste and biodiversity. And we need to come up with that same common vernacular. We need to decide if we've endorsed already the GHG, WRI, WBCSD protocols. But still, you know, it's a challenge on one LCA comes out and says grams, another one says kilograms. They all use different functional units. And so we can't compare any to one another. And so we're really looking to work on that comparison so that we can compare apples to apples. And that's why so many industry competitors are working together, because they want a simple way to harmonize these things and a simple way to be examined and analyzed, particularly by their customers and regulators. We're considering many different areas. We're excited about areas like social. We do have a social hotspots database, originally started at UNEP, and it's been built up. And it gives us the hope for looking at some of these issues in quantified methods, not just qualified. We have a lot of anecdotal things. I myself, coming from HP, have done hundreds, if not thousands, of audits, and I know what it's like to do corrective actions out there in factories. But we need ways to determine what are the numbers of child labor in certain regions, or the wages or the hours that are happening, and how do we make changes more broadly. And finally, providing some common platforms and common tools. The level one, for example, is just, it applies to a product category. So if you think about it, a Tesco or a Walmart probably has about 1 million SKUs in their store. And so if we were to do 1 million LCAs on different products, and that would be a level two, which would be the particular brand name, it would most definitely take us more than a century. But there are about 1,500 product categories. So by the end of this year, we will have taken on about 100 of those product categories. Will we be done with them? No. Can you help us? Yes. We've got a Wikipedia that we're just asking people to add more and more to, and sharing this information. We're within this Wikipedia and knowledge base, we're rating the data as well. But we believe that if we need to do the 1,500 level ones, we'll do that. If we need to do about 600 or 700, and it'll get us into most of the deep global supply chains, then that's great as well. It most definitely will allow us to see where is data missing, where are there gaps, and how can we point to that and research that data. And I think with the companies on board, and in particular the retailers asking their brands, go get this data, we're missing it here. We're likely to have more success. We also have all levels of companies. As you can see, we have the retailers, we have the brands, but we also have all of the chemical companies like Dow and BASF and Novozymes and DuPont and Danisco. And then we have mining and we have forestry and agriculture like Syngenta and Cargill and Tyson and Monsanto. These companies that really hold a lot of the primary data around the world that we have to get to. This is a level two product declaration. Many of you may have seen this, typically called an environmental product APD, that has a lot of quantified data. Level one is more narrative, and it looks something like this. On the first page up in the top, it's a description of the whole process. I'll show you a bigger picture of this graph. Over on the right, we've got icons that mean different things. We've got a listing of the hotspots. So here we're really letting the buyer know, letting the company know, letting the decision makers know, letting the regulators know, letting the policy makers know. There may be 25 impacts associated with this product category, but these are the five real hotspots, the parts of the life stages that require us to focus and that have the greatest impact. And here are some improvement practices in the middle section that go with those. And then finally, different from the hot spots may be hot buttons or stakeholder concerns. So people may believe packaging, of course, has to be there. And it's not to minimize that as an issue, but it is to say it's not coming up as the highest priority based on all of the research and existing science that's been done to date. And this is an example of the graphic, and it shows you a little more where the hotspots are, in particular in a laundry use. People may feel that the companies are shifting the burden by saying it's really in, a lot of the impact is in the consumer use, but in something like laundry detergent, that simply is the fact that about 60 or 70% of the life cycle impact is happening at the washing and drying stage. So what can the company do to redesign the packaging? You've seen what they can they do to redesign the product, doing cold water formulations that clean clothes as well in cold water as hot water, doing compaction to make the product smaller, and doing education as well, and getting incentives for that. So that's an example of a hotspot analysis. This is the knowledge base. It has quite a bit of detail in it. And if you go on our website, you can see some of these screenshots. But we do rate the data that's coming in. For many, we have published LCAs. We do look for LCAs that really are, as my colleague here from CERAG said, we've looked at a lot of the existing LCAs. Honestly, more comfortable with the ones that have been peer reviewed, and are actually published out there. There are many companies that are providing us their data, and we're rating that as well. But in some cases, that data may or may not be biased based on, you know, their product. And we're finding more and more collaboration amongst the companies as well, and sharing and pooling that data. We're also doing modeling, we're doing input-output modeling, we're having some consultants validating it, and we're talking to panels of experts, too. So it's a process we're going through. Finally, I'll just summarize by saying, you know, again, we're quite pleased. I really want to thank Christian and Jody for inviting us and being incredible hosts for us this week and introducing us to many people. And we've got multiple meetings in the next couple of days. And again, I can't say how much we want to collaborate and you know, ensure that we're not duplicating efforts. We know that many other databases exist. We're working closely with entities like EcoInvent and hope to be creating deep partnerships over the next year. We do think that this is about bringing academia and businesses together. Many of you know a lot about LCA, and a lot of folks out there don't. And so bringing your expertise to the table in a pragmatic way, in a way that also acknowledges the return on investment and what is the business case. That's really critical for businesses as we move through this, make sure it's practical and applied. addressing some of the real gaps that exist today in the LCA world and trying to accelerate decisions and tool making on them would be a wonderful contribution as well. And some of these are the gaps that exist, like uncertainty analysis and robustness. Knowing that, you know, LCAs are time intensive and resource intensive, and we're all obviously doing the best we can, communicating the results out to non-experts, and finally, you know, enabling the retailers to really set the right environmental and social performance thresholds and educating the communities along the way. And I haven't said a lot about consumers. We are doing consumer science. We are, you know, right now believe that there's a lot of science and a lot of research and a lot of expertise to bring to the businesses and to bring to the supply chains and the value chains, and we think we can have a huge impact there. A lot of parties are creating indices and creating labels. Today, currently, we're not doing that. We hope to be collaborating with people that are doing that. So with that, there's contact information, and you will receive the slide deck with your information. So again, we're here together to focus on innovation, reduce the impacts, and ultimately secure a much brighter future for most of you in this room who are much younger than I and I know are as passionate about the environment as I am as well. So thank you very much.